Welcome everyone to this video as we walk together in the wow. Severely modest, quiet, not slouching, not goofing off. Just walking together in the wow. Hope everyone's having a great day. I've already had a great day, but a great day isn't good enough, actually. We want something a little better than a great day. Something that we say, you know, puts it over the top. Yesterday I had a tremendous day. I didn't quite put it over the top. Did a wonderful 3-hour video, and everything is starting to get clearer and clearer and clearer. But after the video, what do I do? What do you do after you meditate? What do you do after you have done something that feels really great? It's a letdown, isn't it? So I was just sitting there in my room, not knowing what to do all the rest of the day. And finally, it was getting late at night. I said, wow, this is terrible. And I was listening to, I need to find a song. What can boost me? What can I get that is just make me feel like something intense is happening, important? So I started thinking, what song can I listen to that is really going to make me feel something intense, you know, that's great? I said, okay, what is it? I said, I couldn't think of one. I started saying, uh-oh, isn't there any songs? I began searching on YouTube and ran into troubles because I couldn't find it. I listened to this and to this, and I said, oh boy, I really better dig deeper here. And I really started digging deep and thinking, if there's one song that you could listen to, just one song, think about that, if there's just one song you could listen to, what would it be? And I said, I think there might be one, but I can't remember what it is, and I couldn't remember. And in listening to all this music, I said, wow, music just, it doesn't have it at all, actually. The intensity of music just isn't there at all. And I realized this, I got very depressed. I realized that it's all been a waste of time. Music's a waste of time. It can't even come close to the kind of intensity that we really want, that we get in meditation, where we are dispelling ourselves from the rogue defensive system that we told to ignore us as if we had no control over it. Getting free of that, that's the intensity that we're really looking for. And music just, it falls so flat. It is so far removed from what we really want, the intensity of it. So, you know, I eventually made my way to saying, well, maybe Eric Clapton or something, the blues or something. Let me go to a song like I Can't Find My Way Home with Eric Clapton, Steve Winwood. It's a lot of people think that's just the tastiest song ever. Yeah. No, it fell completely flat. I said, wow, can't use that anymore. That's just not in the ballpark. And tried out George Strait, Amarillo, by morning at the Houston Astrodome. But, you know, that's another one. People say, wow, this just hit a grand slam with that one. And no, flat. Everything was flat. And I got sort of very worried. I said, I can't find anything. This is terrible. I can't even find one song. I cannot even find one song to make me feel any better, actually. What a disgrace. And then, just before I was ready to quit, I said, that's it. I was complaining, and I said, ah. I said, well, there is one song that might do it. You know, there is one, but the others, no, but there is, I said, yeah, there is one. Why didn't I think of that? I said, wait a minute. So I went to this song and listened to it, and it didn't fall flat. You know, it didn't fall flat. It was right in the area where it says, well, at least it didn't fall completely flat, actually. And so I said, okay, well, there's at least one song I can listen to occasionally. But that's it. That's it. Yeah, but then I asked myself, how come I didn't go to that song first? You know, why didn't I go to that song first? Why? What was it that was directing my attention to these other songs? And I got caught up into all sorts of music that I said, this isn't it. Why am I even listening to this? You know, some live performances of rock and roll or various things that are really, you know, hard rock and just all this various stuff. And I said, you know, all along I could have saved all this time and just gone to that one song and say, okay, I know that song at least doesn't fall completely flat. Okay, fine. Then enough of this. But I said I wasted all this time. And then I realized that the great distractor, I call it the rogue goddess who we put in charge of all our servants to manage our servants for us, has gone. We also told it this goddess to go rogue if we ever decided to drop this delusion of time, space, process, and form, this attempt to define what we are, to go rogue and not listen to us and claim that now that this rogue goddess is now actually in charge of us too. So it's this rogue goddess defense which is telling us, sends servants to us, as it were, sends songs to us and says, listen to this. This is the one I want you to listen to. And I realized these songs that I was trying to find a song has to be approved by the rogue goddess. There's different terms for it. Egoic defense system is another way of putting it. But I find that it when it displays, I find it in the form of a goddess, rogue, this goddess who pretends that she doesn't have to listen to you, that, you know, mother knows best type of thing, that you're a child and that she's your mother and therefore she can ignore whatever you say and just tell you she claims she knows what is best for you. So it's this mother goddess, rogue mother goddess, that plays on that and a lot of other aspects that seem to crush our will and think, oh, I really am just a servant. I don't have the power to set this ridiculous whim down of trying to make God less so I can say that I'm greater than God. So I had to get approval. I said, I realized that all the music I was listening to, I was only listening to it because I felt like, well, I needed in order to feel better, the goddess has to agree. I got to get her on my side, this rogue goddess, to stop being so rogue. You know, stop ignoring what I tell the spirits, the servants to say. They're supposed to do what I say. And instead she says, no, you got to go through me first, and then I'll decide whether I want to pass that message on to the servant, your servants or not. The servants are all aspects of our being that serve us. And I said, hey, wait a minute. Or actually, the servants we've made in this world, in this delusion, servants to get us to do what we want, how we feel, what we think, what we eat, what we do, all these, so to speak, psychic servants. So I was trying to find something that both I liked and the goddess would approve of, so that then they would go to the servant and say, okay, you can accept this and you can feel better about it, so to speak. I said, wow, no wonder why I couldn't find it. And the song that I found, you know, is really a song that dismisses the rogue goddess, actually. It's called I don't give a damn, George Jones. I think it's what I just don't give a damn, or I don't give a damn. And basically in the song he says, hey, I've done everything I can do, but no matter what I do, you disagree with me, and so, you know, I'm on the other side of town, I'm gone, and maybe I'll feel lonely, maybe I'll feel bad when in the morning, but right now I just don't give a damn, I don't care. And the song it doesn't fall flat. The production quality, the whole mood, and the singing is, I listened to it very carefully because I was so intent on saying, is this going to fall flat? And the singing is just tremendous job with the subtle nuances, ending phrases, just how everything goes. It's for me that if I had one song to listen to, it would be I Don't Give a Damn by George Jones. That is one heck of a song. But, you know, it's just a song. But the content is very interesting. The content is saying, hey, now, no matter what I do, you always put me down. You know, always disagreed, always put me down. And so, you know, I'm gone, and, you know, I may feel terrible, but I just really don't give a damn right now. And in other words, took a leap of faith. He took a leap of faith and said to the rogue goddess, no, you're not in charge. You're not in charge. And all your threats that you're going to take all the servants and they're going to be disobedient or they're going to leave me and all this kind of stuff. You can say whatever you want to say, but I'm in charge, actually. I'm in charge. I'm in charge. You're not in charge. I just told you that to act that this way as if you were in charge in order to keep, so in order to keep me trying to deceive God. But I don't want to deceive God anymore, you see. That's it. So we have to make this step of will. We have to make this step of will. And we say to the goddess, I don't give a damn what you say or think or are telling me or what you want to discuss or how or whether you need to approve this or that. I don't care. Well, maybe I'll regret it later, but right now I don't care, you see. And this is the leap of faith. It's a big leap of faith to take, because the one thing the goddess doesn't want you to do is the practices that we're doing here. We have a practice now, and in test piloting this practice, there is no question that there's ferocious attempts to try and distract us away from this. The practice is in three phases: the assertions that we do, the full stop, and the wow, as we realize, wow, I'm really doing this. This is really succeeding. This is tremendous. We're shocked by the success of it and our own audacity, really, of daring to just do it anyway and say, I don't care what the ego, rogue goddess ego, I don't care what their reaction is or what they think about it, or I'm not, and I don't care to discuss the matter at all. I'm just doing it. I'm just practicing. That's it. So the assertion, the full stop, and the wow. Like, wow, this is amazing. I'm doing this. Letting that calm down and then flipping the script where you sort of re-energize and regain your nerve to assert once again, to go back to the assertion and practice. And so as we start out, we go through these three phases. Now, the assertion itself that we're going to use is actually also in three phases, is what I've seen. There's a beginning, sort of an intermediate, and then an advanced, okay, of the assertions. So we might spend one hour doing the beginning assertion, the second hour on this middle assertion, and the third hour on the advanced assertion. Now, I've done all three assertions. I've test piloted them, and they're all great. I did the advanced one this morning. What a meditation that was. What an intense meditation that was. Good grief. It is really amazing. When you make a concerted effort to do just one thing in your mind and stick with it, you will find that suddenly your mind will be off on some sidetrack, completely engrossed in some sidetrack that is completely oblivious to the practice you're supposed to be practicing. The mind has suddenly gone rogue. The mind has suddenly gone rogue on you. This is the distraction. This is the sidetracking. This is the attempt to distract your attention, which is the whole thing about the ego, the rogue goddess, the ego. That's what we made it for. To distract us away from truth. So truth is not stating that lies are lies. Truth is merely stating that truth is true. Okay, for the most part. We do put in there, I am not a body, okay. But that is true. It is simply truth states what is true. In our assertions, we simply say, truth is true, is all we're saying. We're saying truth is true. And what is wrong with that? Nothing. We're not attacking lies at all. We're not attacking lies at all. Now, as usual here, I've not eaten breakfast. What time is it? It's 1 o'clock already in the afternoon. I've not eaten any breakfast. I haven't even been drinking anything. I've been meditating all morning. And for me, I did what's called a power meditation where I stayed with the assertion the whole time for, I don't know, hour and a half maybe. well, let's say an hour, solid, intense hour of this, of just the assertion. Now, this is what's called an intensive, assertion intensive, okay? So we're using the terminology. We have a practice now, so what we're getting used to is the terminology and just the basic, the basics to get used to it. The basic conventions, okay? The basic conventions. And so this would be like an assertion intensive, where we go for 1 hour straight with an assertion, just straight, and find out this incredible. When you do this, you really become more and more convinced that the situation is as the Holy Spirit, as the Spirit of Truth and Reason has shown it to us, that it really is. We told ourselves to distract ourselves. We have this distraction mechanism, we call the ego, the rogue goddess, that when we try to get free, it believes it has to distract us and insists that we be distracted. And so there is progress that is made in meditation. I'm seeing it, of how you simply don't judge any distraction at all. You just realize, oh, and go snap right back to practicing. You don't attack the distraction. You don't analyze it. You don't judge it. Because we're not trying to analyze or judge lies. Okay? We're simply trying to assert the truth. All we do here is assert the truth. We assert the truth. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. This is the truth that we are asserting here. This is the root practice. This is a convention we use, because the rest of it, in meditation, you want to have something to go back to. This is the key. What I've found is that wasting time, which most of us have wasted our whole lives, is we get into arguments with the ego. We get into discussing lies. We get into analyzing lies, categorizing lies, thinking about lies. This is what the ego wants. The ego wants us to engage with the ego and prove to the ego why it's a lie, etc., etc. This doesn't work. This doesn't work at all. This keeps us totally sidetracked, and we don't really remember what truth is at all. In meditation, this practice that we have, we assert the truth. That's it. So when we see that we've been sidetracked, and it can happen like that, it is amazing what happens. You'll be going along great guns, and then the next moment, you realize you completely have forgotten about the practice, and don't have the faintest notion that you were ever even practicing, and you're off on some sidetrack. And just, wow. And what do you do? Go right back to the practice. Okay, I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is the root practice. So you know where home is. You reorient yourself towards home. I had a dream last night that we were running this marathon along this road, and suddenly I realized, oh my gosh, there's my street that takes me home. You know, and I almost went past it, but somehow I struggled off to the side of there's all these marathon, all these runners are running, and I struggled off to the side of the road and stopped there right by my street. I said, wow, I almost missed it. And then I said, well, the signage was wrong. That's why I almost missed it. And then I looked at the sign, and it was actually spelled right. I said, wow, it was my distortion. I didn't see it properly. I almost missed it. Holy cow. But if I hadn't been practicing, I would have missed it for sure. I would have had my attention on what? What does the ego want you to have attention on? Bodies. People. Bodies. People. Okay. So in our practice, we're not focusing on bodies or people at all. In fact, we state right off the bat, I am not a body. Okay, get that right up front. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So I was able to get off this marathon route, and then once I did, I began to look at it, and I realized this marathon route is a sidetrack. It's all those who are sidetracked. It's the momentum of being sidetracked from what? From home. And this street was not a side street. This street is the main street, is home. It's where home is. And it's this street that goes across it. That's the sidetrack. It's all those running the marathon who are sidetracked. And what their attention on is on bodies. And I was fighting to keep my attention off of bodies during this running, the bodies ahead of me. I said, no, don't look at the bodies. Don't look at bodies. Keep your attention. And that's when I saw the sign. I said, hey, wait a minute. That looks like that might be my street. I noticed some featured. I said, wait a minute. That might be my street. But the sign, I'm not sure. And I kind of went past a little bit and looked. And then there were some friends there who said, no, this is it. This is it here. And they kind of helped grab me and secure me and make sure I stopped. Because I had my attention off of bodies just to some extent. So it is absolutely imperative to get our attention off of bodies. This is why we must practice explicitly getting our attention off of bodies and asserting, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is a very powerful and effective assertion. And why even do this at all is the question. Well, we've answer that over and over and over and over again, is you will remain sidetracked if you don't do this. And being sidetracked means a lot of misery, a lot of suffering, a lot of dissatisfaction, a lot of feeling like I just can't find what I really want, a lot of fear, a lot of anxiety, a lot of false stimulation, a lot of false teachings. You get engrossed in what you don't really want. You get engrossed in what you don't really want. And you feel enslaved by it. And you feel the ego rogue goddess is in charge of you. And you have to go through them to get whatever you want. And of course, they'll never give you truth. Their whole purpose is to not give you truth, give you fake truth, falsities, lies, and dress it up in a pretty ways and make it think that it should satisfy you. So essentially, if you don't practice, you will remain very dissatisfied, to say the least. And that means you will remain suffering. You will remain in misery. You will remain in desperation. You will remain in boredom. You will remain in everything you want to get rid of. You don't want that. You will for sure remain in it. There's no question about it. From what I've been through in my life, I can say for sure you will remain in it. If you do not practice, you will remain in all of that until you do start practicing. So what we're doing here is we're making it easy to practice by, first of all, the most important step is to say we do have a practice. See, what I found in my life is the ego prevents us from actually getting a practice. It distracts us. It wants us to keep analyzing forever. It wants to make sure we never settle upon any practice, but think that we're better than that. You know, no, I could find something better. Or, well, maybe this just isn't my cup of tea. Or, always the ego will be making excuses for us. And then we're stuck in thinking and thinking and thinking and thinking instead of practicing. Always. And you will waste your entire life this way if you don't practice, if you don't find a practice. So here we are explicitly stating we have a practice for you. For all of us. And the star is not me or you, it's the practice. The practice is the star of all this. Okay. Who's the big guru here? The practice is the big guru. Okay. Get this into your heart, into your being, let this permeate through to the truth within you, which is not located anywhere. It's everywhere. It's a knowing. It's an intuitive knowing, right? Let this permeate into your knowing. Which is neither heart nor head, nor both, nor neither, is, you know, both, whatever. It is this sense, feeling like, yeah, I know this is true. I know this is true. But yeah, it's going to be tough. Well, we got to be spiritual Marines, don't we? Absolutely, we have to be spiritual Marines. How do you do that? You earn your stripes. You go through boot camp. You earn it. Nobody says, oh, you're a spiritual Marine because you look nice. Nobody's going to ever say that. Okay, truth will never say that. You earn it, because being a spiritual Marine is something that you know you've impressed yourself. And how do you do that? By practicing. It's the only way. I never had that feeling, no matter how much I analyzed and thought I knew. I always felt, no, I'm missing. I can't say that I've really impressed myself. Actually, I can't really say that. But when you meditate like this, you impress yourself. You really do. This morning, I really impressed myself. So I said that, and yesterday and the day for doing these three-hour videos, I really impressed myself in this meditation of one-hour intensive, assertion intensive. My gosh, that was impressive. That stacks, you know, I can say, hey, that's what a spiritual Marine does. You know, what you do is what you are, so to speak. And if you're doing as a spiritual Marine does, you are a spiritual Marine, okay? Which means you're confident. You don't get pushed around or bullied, or you're confident in your success. You know you've already succeeded, actually. This is a reenactment of what you've already succeeded at, and therefore you're going to succeed at this reenactment. Okay. We're already enlightened. Everyone is already enlightened. Okay. They're just pretending they're not. And so they're afraid to let go of their pretense. So what we do is we hold on to perception, which in itself is a pretense. But we use perception and faith. Perception is based on faith. Faith that we that can deceive God, deceive ourselves actually, and thereby deceive God. We use faith in a different way. We flip the script of faith and use it in a positive way. Say, I know I've already succeeded. This is a reenactment, a perceptual faith-based reenactment of our already enlightenedness. So since we're already enlightened, how can we fail? All we have to do is do it. Is do the reenactment, and then we'll impress ourselves so much by doing this reenactment that then we'll say, yeah, okay, I really do deserve enlightenment. I really impressed myself. I've really honored my creativity by doing this. See, we need to honor our creativity as the last step here, and by meditating like this, we are honoring our creativity. This is a very creative thing to do, what we're doing here. Very creative assertion, full stop in the wow, flip the script, repeat. Three phases of intensity. This is a very, very creative way of going about it and honoring our creativity. And we feel that. We say, wow, this is good and this is great. This is really great. I'm very impressed. I've impressed myself by doing this. So it is not enough for someone to impress you. You cannot go to a great guru and be very impressed by the great guru and say that's enough. It will not be enough. It will never be enough. You have to impress yourself. There's no way around that. That's why we say the great guru here is the practice itself. Okay? Is the practice itself. Now, there are great gurus behind this practice who have helped bring this to my attention, so I'm able to bring it to your attention here. But they're not the stars. The star of this show, is the practice itself. So if you're not doing the practice, you're not doing anything here, really. There's nobody here, there's no guru here other than the practice, actually. If you want to pay attention to the spiritual master, the bodhisattva, the saint, the sage, the guru, pay attention to the practice and do the practice. Because that's the bodhisattva, savior, sage, saint, guru, etc. That is it. This is the means of grace. This is the means of grace. The practice is the means of grace. This has been very clearly pointed out to me by those who have already succeeded, completely succeeded at this, and absolutely know, who have tested this out perfectly well, and they know that the practice is God's grace. And your willingness to do it is God's grace. The practice is the guru. You're doing the practice is the guru. Okay. And you are impressing yourself by doing so. No other way to do it. Don't say, well, I went and saw this guru, blah, blah, blah. That's not impressive. And this is one of the reasons I'm able to bring this to your attention. I'm able to function in this way here in this world, is I have met with some of the greatest teachers and gurus in history. I'm aware of what they're like. I'm aware. So... And so it doesn't awe me at all. Somebody says, well, I went to see this great Sadguru or this. Okay, fine. But that doesn't impress me. Okay? Because I've already been through that and it wasn't enough. It was not enough. Not enough. Didn't get the job done. It is this practicing that I'm seeing. This is getting the job done. So I'm more impressed by that I'm able to do this meditation, this assertion, full stop on the wow, flip the script, That's way more impressive than going to see, for instance, Ramana Maharshi or anyone, any great teacher, whatever. Okay, it's more impressive than that. Way more impressive. And they'll be the first to tell you that. They'll be the first to tell you that. So don't be a spiritual grasshopper. Okay. You know that, or that kung fu thing, the grasshopper is always called grasshopper. Why? Because grasshopper is always hopping. You know, the mind, like the mind's always hopping, looking for something else. You don't want to be a spiritual grasshopper. Absolutely not. Because that doesn't impress yourself at all. You're not trying to impress the teachers, the gurus, the masters. You're not trying to impress them. You're trying to impress yourself. Because only when you impress yourself are you going to say, okay, I really am in charge. I really deserve being in charge. I really honored my creativity. I really accept that I'm already enlightened. And when you get to that point, you will, your attention will relax into the non-dual attentiveness, the relaxed attentiveness of non-dualness, which is, you know, this is ultimately the goal. It will relax, but you got to get there first. You have to impress yourself first. Really impress yourself, really honor your creativity. Now, what phase are we in right now? Flipping the script phase, right? We're always in one phase of the teachings. We're either asserting, full stop in the wow, no spin zone of the wow, just like letting the wow just settle down, or we're flipping the script, we're talking. So flipping the script is a way of encouraging us to practice, getting our nerve up to practice, to actually do it. Seeing it in a way we say, yeah, I can see that this is, yeah, I really do need to bring my will into the picture. We're not just trying to go and be pretty for some guru, okay? That doesn't work. Forget about it. We're not trying to show up at some guru's ashram in the appropriate ashram clothes, in the appropriate look of, wow, I'm a pilgrim on the path, and I've got the right beads and bracelets and malas, and I've got the right mannerisms. I know how to say the right things. I mean, there's some people who are so good at listening to non-dual talk. They're so good at asking the right non-dual questions and putting the right non-dual terminology and stuff, trying to impress the teacher. Forget it. You know, you show it. What is that? There's nothing. You're trying to impress the teacher. Teacher doesn't want you to try and impress them. It wants you to impress yourself. And you might say, well, then I'm not going to go see a teacher at all. I'm going to find someone else who wants to be impressed. Well, that's being a spiritual grasshopper. Right? A teacher is there to turn your attention on the real guru, which is the practice. Okay. That's the real pragmatic guru. Okay, that's the guru function. The practice is the guru function. Guru refers to a function, actually. A pragmatic function. The teacher, if it's an enlightened teacher, is enlightened, is in the non-dual attention, the attention of non-duality. But they're not the star. The star is always has to be pragmatic, and the pragmatism is in the practice. The pragmatism is in the practice. And that practice is the one song that says, you know, yeah, that's good enough. I'll do that. I'll listen to that song. The rest of the songs, they just don't have that something, you know. But this practice, it has that something. It has that sizzle. It digs into it, you know. It's sharp, you know. It's like if you want to like drill through quarter inch steel, you need a really sharp bit, and the bit's gonna get dulled by doing it. But you need a really sharp bit. You try to do a dull bit through quarter inch steel, you're gonna get nowhere. You're just gonna heat up the drill. It's gonna heat up and overheat, and probably ruin the drill, because the friction is too much. So you have to have a very sharp bit to drill through the resistance that we have, because we told this egoic structure, rogue goddess, to go rogue on us. We told the goddess to go rogue on us when we decide to finally drop this attempt to deceive God. And so she goes rogue on us, absolutely does. And I've experienced that. I experienced this goddess. It was incredible. Coming into this world, where this world is going very rogue right now. It's a rogue goddess world right now. And I experienced this, literally, this goddess coming through, being released from this prison, has these bars, as it were, which is our own restraint, imprisoning her, keeping her in prison. The door opened, and she was allowed to come into this world. And I faced her, and she was going right towards me. And I looked at her, I said, oh my God, she had the most vehemently angry and hostile, baleful look you could ever imagine. It's enough to paralyze, turn you into stone. She was Medusa. And I tried to joke her. I said, hey, have you learned your lesson yet? Have you realized this is all folly? You realize it doesn't work? And I was, you know, bantering with her. And she just gave me this most ferocious, willful look. You know, like, you're nothing. You're nothing. I'm in charge. You're absolutely nothing. Who are you, you miserable slave? You know, that's what, and she just walked right past me with just seething with hostile intent. Like, I am going to put this world right, is her. You could feel, I'm going to put this world under my spell and enslave everybody, and everyone's going to do what I say. You know, and so the will was just incredibly intense. And it just shocked me, it rocked me. I said, holy cow, how does anyone stand up to that? Well, you need a very sharp bit to drill through that. You need a very sharp practice to dispose of that. Very sharp, okay? So I've been working and working, my whole life working. Let's get a sharp practice, a practice that is so sharp that it will bit by bit by bit dispose of that vehement, baleful will, that the will of the rogue goddess, the goddess whose purpose is to enslave your will, your spiritual will, and to crush it, to enslave it, and to say you have no will whatsoever to ever drop this dream of time, space, process, and form, that you don't have the will. It's gone. And in order to do anything, you have to go through me first, and I will never okay dropping time, space, process, and form. This is the situation you'll find yourself in, that you don't have the will. You'll feel you simply don't have the will. If you don't practice, you'll find out soon in this world, you will feel you simply don't have the will. You say, I just don't have the will. I'm just this helpless, hopeless little human being here, subject to death and sickness and the boredom of just these cycles of existence, and you'll feel you don't have the will. This is what happens. So it's like this plate of steel there, a quarter-inch steel, and you say, wow, I got no way can I get through that, you'll think, just no way. Well, if you've got this very sharp drill bit, and the drill is the will to do it, okay? You put that drill bit, the drill bit is the practice. The drill itself is the will. Put those two together, and you go. You start going right through that steel, bit by bit. It takes a little while to go through that steel, for sure. It's hardened steel, but the drill bit is even harder than the steel. You see, this practice is intense enough to bit by bit dispel the will to distraction, the will to distract our will, which we ourselves have imagined is some sort of power external to us. There is no will, there is no power external to us, but we have imagined there is. The ego, the rogue goddess, that is insisting that their will is stronger than ours. And we'll say, okay, we'll find out who's stronger here. And so you just start practicing. And they say, well, you can't drill through that. Or, here, let me help you. Or, wow, you're making a lot of progress. You must be tired. You know? And all these things jump in to try to distract you. And say, yeah, well, you know, no, I'm just practicing. That's all. Just drilling. I'm just drilling through drilling through this steel here. That's all I'm doing. So be very humble. You say, no, I'm just, you know, when I get through, then we'll talk once I get through. Because then we'll have something to talk about. Right? Right? Because you're the assertion on that side, the ego says, no, you can't do it. And I'm saying, I can. So we don't have anything to talk about at this point, because I'm in the process of actually doing it now. And so once I finish, then we'll have something to talk about. And I'll say, wait, you know, see, I'm right. And ego, you're wrong. You're mistaken. Right now, we don't have anything to talk about. So it is necessary to bit by bit by bit dispose of this intensely hostile will that we ourselves have imagined in order to derail us from returning home, essentially. It means setting down this effort to try and deceive God by deceiving ourselves first and then claiming that since we're one with God, God must be deceived also. See, this is what we've tried to do. We have been trying to deceive ourselves, and we're spirit. Spirit is an extension of God. In strict monotheism, they don't talk of God, the Trinity of God, the Father, God, the Son, and God, the Holy Spirit. For instance, Islam is strictly monotheistic, doesn't have the Trinity, okay, which is fine. But you can use a term to talk God. All is God. There's only God. But God extends God. This extension of God, we can say, is God the Spirit. Okay, you can say that. It's not separate or different. It's still God. It's God the Spirit. It's all one essence. All God. All is God, yes. So, we can use that terminology here. It's okay. This God the Spirit had this idea. It's very adventurous. It's very expansive. Of, hey, maybe we can somehow be greater than God the Prime Creator. That is the idea of expansion. We can expand beyond the idea of expansion, in other words. We can expand beyond the idea of expansion of God. And so we said, how do we do that? And what we decided on is we will make God less. You know, God is all. We said, we can't be more than all, but maybe we can make ourselves less than all. And since we're one with God, if we make ourselves less than all, if we bind ourselves, then we're binding God, and we're making God less than what God is, and therefore we think we're greater. Sometimes we've triumphed over God. We've somehow expanded beyond expansion. This is just a way of talking about it. It clues us into it. So we have tried to deceive ourselves with time, space, process, and form as if we are somehow limited, as if Spirit, God the Spirit, is somehow limited. Now, God the Holy Spirit is merely us, God, the oneness, reminding us that we're not limited. We can't be limited. And this is all just a dream. And that pragmatically there's a way to awaken from the dream. So the Holy Spirit is honors our creativity. It's basically saying there's no such thing as time, space, process, and form, but we honor our creativity in all the attempt to do so, to imagine all this. We've imagined all this. It's a very creative attempt on our part. So we don't want to attack all that we've done or vilify it. We merely want to use our creativity, flip the script, and use our creativity, use our faith, which we've been using, faith, in a positive way to help us realize that none of this actually ever happened. Nothing ever happened. Because if we were just saying, nothing's ever happened, drop it, you're bad, you're wrong thinking that way, we feel that this is attacking our creativity. It's not honoring our creativity, and we don't like that. We don't go for that. So what we take is a loving, gentle, loving approach of the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, which is, again, God functioning in this pragmatic way, dealing with this, with God the Son, the Spirit's attempt to deceive itself and God. Okay, so this is just a little background theory of this, flipping the script. We're working on flipping the script here right now. So we have faith that all time, space, process, and true is real. It's not. It's based on faith 100%. So what we do, we don't criticize faith, which is the foundation of all this creativity of imagining. We say, okay, faith, let's imagine that we've already succeeded in dropping all this. And they say, hey, that's a very creative approach, that we've already done this. Not that we're doing it. We've already done it. See, put your faith in that we've already done it. And see, our spirit says, wow, I like this. That's a very audacious, adventurous approach. See, spirit loves adventure. It loves audacity and adventure. It loves this. This is what it is. Experiencing whatever, freedom, the freedom to experience whatever. So to say that we've already done it, that's very audacious. So Spirit loves this, and Spirit says, yeah, let's practice this way. Let's practice this way. I've already done it. So this is our second phase of intensity of practice. The first one is to assert, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is the audacity of stating the truth in the face of all this plausible imaginary pretense, which is also very audacious, and spirit loves that audacity. See, what we don't want to lose in setting down this dream of self-deception is we do not want to lose our audacious adventurousness. We don't want to lose that. And we're afraid we might lose that. You see, this is our fear, right? We're thinking, oh my gosh, if I admit that nothing's ever happened, and maybe I'll just sit in reality and just say, being adventurous is terrible. It doesn't work. I can't do it anymore. And, you know, we'll be just this pitiful case. So we want this feeling that we're not going to lose that audacious spirit of audacious adventurousness. So by saying, I am not a body, that is very audacious. We live in this world where there's 7 billion bodies, right? And to say, I am not a body, it's just like, wow, that's very audacious. I am free. Again, we feel like we're body, we're bound, we're not free. I mean, we have to go through all the processes of nature to do anything, right? Now we're saying, I am free of all that. I am free, period. I am completely free. Very audacious. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Again, stating this in the face of this massive body of imaginary pretense that states that we've changed. Super audacious to say this. So it is this statement, this practice, this root practice, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me, is an incredibly audacious statement of a very audacious adventure, okay? Very much so. So it has the honoring of our creativity, of our true nature within it. It has it within it. So spiritually, we feel, yeah, I can do this practice because this truly honors what I truly am. What I truly am. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. By saying this, we get this wow feeling, like saying, wow, that is audacious. Okay. Now, it was certainly very audacious to try and deceive ourselves, wasn't it? Okay, so that's already there. And yet, to set that down, realizing, well, we don't really want to keep doing that because it wasn't really so enjoyable. We need to maintain our feeling of being very audaciously adventurous. And so by saying, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me, this is super audacious. All right. So this is the root practice. The root practice has to have this leap of faith, or called flipping faith, into this audacity of saying, I'm already free, basically. It's saying, I'm not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. It has this audacity of faith, using faith in the right way. Now, the second intensity of our practice is, and our practice is the guru, okay? So that's what we pay attention to. The second phase is to say, I am already, yes, I already know, I am already free. Yes, I already know, I've already succeeded. Yes, I already know, I am already enlightened. This takes the intensity of audacity up another notch. Not only are we audacious enough to state the truth of what we are in the face of seemingly massive evidence to the contrary, although all the evidence is fake, actually. We're all pretending. We're just pretending. It's fake evidence, but still, it seems very plausible. So, not only are we asserting, first we asserted that this audacity in the face of all this plausible evidence, and now we are asserting not only that, but that we've already succeeded with the practice. We've already succeeded. See, this is very audacious to say this, because this takes time, space, process, and form entirely out of the situation, doesn't it? I've already succeeded. Yes, I already know that I've already succeeded at this practice. Yes, I already know that I am already enlightened. So this is the second phase. This is the second phase. This is the second level of intensity, let's say. This is the second intensity, the mid-intensity beginning intensity, or beginning intensity, mid intensity, and then high intensity. What is the high intensity? High intensity is when you put the beginning and mid intensity together and say like this: I am already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And I'm already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, and I'm already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This is high intensity, where you bring this whole notion of alreadiness. This is the key of flip using faith in the mid-intensity, is you use this term and focus already. It's already done. I'm already there. I'm already here. I've already succeeded. Already, already, already. This really is a sharp drill bit. It really, the time just has nothing to say. It's already out of the picture. There's nothing to discuss or say or anything. I'm already here. I've already succeeded. There's no discussion of can I succeed at all. I've already succeeded. So it just completely shuts out the whole ego discussion here. Very intense, but it's mid-intensity. And then even beyond that, you combine beginning and mid-intensity for the third intensity, the high intensity, which is what I did this morning. I practiced this high intensity meditation assertion of, I'm already so delighted that I already see, I'm already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me, and I am already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, and I'm already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And the third, I just suffered internet dropout, internet connection dropout, so I have to edit these two videos together. The third is flipping the script. So we have these three phases of our practice and three intensities. Three phases, three intensity, three levels of intensity. Each level of intensity has the three phases of practice, which is assertion, full stop, and the wow, flip the script. So in phase one, assertion, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Then we say this until we get to this wow, like, wow, this is really succeeding, this is amazing. Calm down a little bit, then start flipping the script, which brings us back to asserting again. And we practice this way. The second level of intensity is the mid-intensity is, I already know that I'm already free. So this assertion, and then that brings a wow, and we full stop on the wow. We flip the script once that's calmed down, and go back to the assertion. Okay, same thing with the high level of intensity, which is, so I already know, so I am already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me, and I'm already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay, that, and then in that intensity, we have the three practice phases: assertion, full stop in the wow, flip the script. It's exactly the same, the three basic phases of practice. The three basic steps of practice. The three steps are always the same. The three steps are always the same in no matter what intensity you're practicing. So for instance, in a 3-hour practice period, we can have 1 hour on intensity one, 1 hour on mid intensity, 1 hour on high intensity, 1 hour beginning intensity, 1 hour middle intensity, 1 hour high intensity, like that. And in each of these intensities, we'll have the three steps are always in play. Assertion, full stop, and the wow. Flip the script. Very simple. Very simple. Very simple. Now, this video is not going to be 3 hours because I cannot edit together a 3-hour video on YouTube. The most you can edit is 2 hours and 10 minutes. But I can continuously record a 3-hour taping on Ustream and then upload that to YouTube. As long as it's a continuous video, it can be as long as you want. You just can't use the video editor to splice segments together longer than 2 hours and 10 minutes. Since this has dropped out, the internet connection dropped out on me, which it did yesterday too. Or the day before. The day before it did drop out. Didn't drop out yesterday. The day before it did. So it's not stable. It's not stable connection for some reason. Which is fine. So we're not going to do a 3-hour video here. We're laying out the parameters of our practice. We have a practice. Super important practice. Now, the ego rogue goddess will throw all sorts of practices. Say, why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? Why don't you compare? Why don't you try to distract us from actually doing the practice? For sure. Very successful at that. In fact, the very fact that we are not in the our attention is not non-dual at this point is due to the success of distraction and nothing else. So you have to realize that the distraction is very successful at what it does. Otherwise, we wouldn't even be sitting here practicing like this. Our attention would already be non-dual attention, actually. And non-dual attention, you say, well, what's that? Well, look at Raman Maharshi, okay? That's non-dual attention right there. You don't need to say any more than that. When you have that, you have non-dual attention, okay? We're not there yet. And the distraction, it will often be to distract us to some practice that is not sharp enough, and so we're trying to drill through that steel, that wall of steel will, you know, will to distract us and to fail. And as we're trying to drill through it, it heats up too much. The drill heats up too much. The drill gets overheated. It stops working. And we say, oh, I can't do this. This is ridiculous. Why am I even trying to do this? It's stupid. Why don't I just take it easy and enjoy life? And the goddess says, yeah, I'll help you do that, as a matter of fact. I'll help you plant all sorts of flowers and beautiful music and sensuality. And we'll laugh and we'll cavort and we'll sing and we'll eat wonderful food and we'll do some spiritual chanting, you know, make ourselves feel good. Of course they include some of that, you know, a little spiritual chanting and appeal to the praise of the goddess, you know, praise of Mother Earth, praise of time, space, process, and form, and say how happy we are to be here, and we'll have this wonderful religion. We'll even make up a religion around it, and why don't we just do that? The goddess says, I'll help you do that, and she certainly will. She most certainly will help you do that, but actually, she'll use you and run you into the ground because she hates you, because she knows you have the will, actually, to call her on this deceit, this scheme, and say, no, I'm in charge, actually. You're just a servant that I told you to go rogue, but you're not really in charge at all. She knows that. And so the ego knows that and wants to put you out of business for good. Wants to put you out of business. So look, have a nice primrose path that you walk along, but the goal is to put you out of business for good. So you had better realize what's going on. And the drill bit has to be sharp. So I've spent a lifetime trying to say, hey, where is a practice that's sharp enough? You know, I keep looking. I said, this isn't it. And the goddess says, look here. I say, no, that's not good enough. Look here. That's not good enough. It's like looking for a song that was good enough. You know, I said, no, this isn't good enough. And finally, I said, well, yeah, this one song, it has that intensity to it, really. Actually has some intensity to it. And of course, we can play the game of, well, all conceptuality doesn't have enough intensity, but that's a goddess game, again, to deflate our will, saying, well, what's the use? Nothing works. Nothing's strong enough. Well, see, that's not true, because flipping faith, that is strong enough, actually. It is sharp enough. Sure, it's still in the realm of conceptuality and perception, but once perception is healed, we're so delighted, we're overflowing with delight that once we get that intermediate step, it's easy to realize, then to relax into pure non-dual attention from there. It's easy. As Ramana Maharshi said, the great bliss is not the final step, but it's a very important step. Okay, the overflowing with blissness is a very important step. But there's one step beyond that, which we will relax into that automatically without any will on our part. The will is inherently within it. Overflowing with delight is the will, is the grace of God, which automatically will resolve into the great silence, the great peace, the great calm, the great tranquility, which Ramana said is even greater than the great bliss. So, we don't need to make the great peace, calm, peace, silence our goal, because first we have to honor our creativity. Otherwise, we're not going to let it go at all, this dream at all. And we honor our creativity through flipping faith and using faith in I am already free. I am already succeeded. I am already here. Yes, I already know that I'm already so delighted that I already see, that I already am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. This is something I already am experiencing. See, I already know that I already know. This is a creative use of faith that honors our creativity. And this leads to this overflowing delightfulness, the great bliss, as some have said, like Ramana would say, the great bliss. And then the great bliss will, at some point, when it feels that the creativity has been honored, and it will know, it will relax attention into the great peace automatically. We don't have to do anything about that. Our practice is not worried about that at all. It's not concerned with that. And so the ego will say, hey, well, you know, we have a practice that will get us to the great peace directly. To, well, you know, that's an attempt to deflate your will, to get you off of doing what you need to do, the practice you actually need to do. Okay? And that's a gambit, a trick that is used, is to say, oh yeah, well, we've got something even better, we got something even higher. Well, fine, if you got something higher, do it. But meanwhile, we're doing this, okay? We're not worried about someone else's practice. See, the goddess tries to get you, the rogue goddess tries to get you to be concerned about some other's practice and comparing practice. We're not interested in comparing. Once you got a sharp enough drill bit, then you know all you got to do is drill through that steel. That's it. Are you going to sit around and say, well, I got a really sharp drill bit, but let me spend the rest of my life arguing over who has the sharpest drill bit, you know? Right. Or analyzing, well, could it be sharper? Is it sharper enough? This is what the rogue, the ego will tell you to do, and will induce you into doing that. So I have enough faith in this practice to say, you know what, this is sharp enough. This is very sharp, as a matter of fact. It is exceedingly sharp. It's not too sharp. If the genius of it is the three steps of assertion, full stop, and the well, flip the script. This is the genius of it. We don't try to just go straight on through. We drill, and then we back off a little bit and say, okay, let the drill cool down a little bit. So we don't want to overheat the drill, right? Because we understand no matter how sharp the drill bit is, there's going to be friction with our defense system, our defenses. There'll be friction. We don't want the friction to get too severe. So we back off a little bit. And then we convince ourselves to drill some more. That's flipping the script. This is the genius of this practice. There's a tremendous genius in this practice. And then we have the three intensities, beginning, middle, and high intensity, of like speeds on a drill. You might be going sort of a slow speed, you know, so you don't want to get too much friction. Then you go mid-speed, get a little more friction, and then high speed, it's really going fast, and it's drilling fast, and there's a lot of heat and friction, okay? It's like, just like that. But of course, the high friction goes a lot faster, doesn't it? And so, but high friction is, the high intensity practice is done because of our discipline of the three steps of our practice assertion, full stop, and the wow. Flip the script. So when we're being a spiritual marine, we're disciplined. And we don't say, oh, great, I've got this high intensity. Now I'm just going to do this, and I'm going to drink coffee for the next 5 days. And if I just power right through it, I'll be right. No, you're going to overheat the drill. You're going to overheat your will. You're going to feel so much success that you'll get giddy and start feeling like you have no definition at all. And you start panicking and getting jittery because you're not ready for that. And you feel, I'm not quite ready to set it all down, but I'm going too fast. And then the wheels fall off, and then you'll get very distracted. And then even despondent, say, well, I can't do anything then. If I can't do it that way, I can't do anything. So we have built-in safeguards against that here. Three steps, three intensities. 3 steps to the practice, 3 intensities of practice. 3 steps to the practice, 3 intensities of practice. And we go from one to another. Okay. We go from one to another. We're not trying to big time the whole thing. We're going from one to the other. We'll spend an hour on this intensity, an hour on this intensity, an hour on the other intensity. Okay. And at this point, this is where we're at with the practice. And I guarantee you that in high intensity practice, there's all the intensity anyone can handle. Okay. There is all the intensity that anyone can handle, actually. So we don't need to say, well, you know, big time and say, well, you know, the first 2 intensities, whatever, let's get to the highest one. Let me just do power through this. I want like 16 hours a day of this, and, you know, help me with that. Otherwise, I'm not interested. No. An hour of that very intense intensity is all that anyone can handle, because the more confidence you get, the more your assertions are carry intensity with them, and the greater the wow is going to be. So if you're really advanced, you're going to get a tremendous wow in like an hour of intense practice, all that you can handle. And the next time you do it, you can same, because your intensity of assertion is stronger, which brings up even more wow. You're going even faster, which brings up more friction. You see? So there isn't any big timing of it here. We're happy to have 3 steps in our practice and 3 phases of intensity. At this time, at where we're at right now, we're not going to lock ourselves into this, because we're free, we're creative, we're free. We're not going to freeze ourselves in this, but we're saying, this is where we're at right now. This is where we're at with our practice. And we're not searching for anything else at this point. If something else comes up, fine. But yet this practice remains too. Okay, it remains. It's a foundation. How you decorate your house at some point, once the house is built, that's a question once the house is built. But the foundation remains the same, right? Strong foundation. Now, who will start? Those who really want to succeed will actually say, I have a practice. Meaning, I have a guru. This practice is intended to be the guru. This is why I've worked with those who had this in mind. I said, I don't want to be a big guru. I've already had a lifetime of being famous. I didn't like it. I said, wow, been there, done that. So I don't really want to be some big shot guru who says, I'm it. Okay. So I was able to work with those great teachers who they themselves, of course, have already done it and been famous and well known. And they understand that that's not it. It's the practice that's it. So I was willing to work with them to get this practice here, and let the practice be the star. Let the practice be the guru. Now I've got a little side role. bringing this to everyone's attention, and getting it into format here, formatting it, which I'm able to do. I was a composer in a previous life, musical composer, and so I was able to take abstract musical ideas and put them into a format so the orchestra could play it. So I have that capacity to use that capacity to get this very abstract, incredibly sharp practice into a basic format where we can all hear it, you see, where we can all hear the song. So, oh, there's a song there. Great. It's a good enough song. You see, I'm very picky about songs. It has very high standards. This song's got to be very sharp, or else it's just, forget it. Forget it. It's not even worth listening to. So this practice, for me, my standards are it has to be very sharp. And this practice, I feel, in testing out is very, very sharp indeed. So nobody is going to come complain, say, oh, the practice isn't sharp enough, and oh, it needs to be so much better. I need to find something. I'm way past that. No, this, forget that. Yeah, I'm not going to fall for that. This practice is extremely sharp, designed by those who have already gone beyond all practice. Okay. And so they know, very well know what is sharp enough. You know, it's not like they're defending against sharp practice. I don't want to make it so sharp because I'm afraid of it. No, they say, look, we know what is very sharp practice. And so it's just a matter of doing it, isn't it? So I've tried out the three phases already. They're all good. None of them causes any extreme disturbance. The only problem that arises is if you overdo it. That's the only problem. And that is just a matter of you get weary. You get weary and you need to sleep. For instance, yesterday I did a three-hour taping, and I slept for an hour and a half. After that, just like, wow, I'm weary. This is a big effort because the resistance is extreme. It's saying, no, abandon this effort. Try something else. This isn't it. You know, you just intense resistance. The rogue goddess doesn't like this at all. So it's tiring, you know, getting this into format again and putting it out into the world. You know, it's like a composition. It's like releasing a great symphony to the world, and it's tiresome work. And for you, of course, it will be tiresome. You need to just take a nap, rest, relax. Don't take coffee to keep going. Just say, I'm tired. But you get better and better at it, your ability to handle it. But so the only difficulty is if you overdo it. But if you overdo it, you're just going to feel very tired and you just want to rest. Say, I just don't feel like practicing. I'm so tired. So the key is to don't overdo it to the extent that the next day you can't practice. You're still wiped out. That's overdoing it. You want consistency. You want to do it every day. But you want each day to be intense enough where you're going to feel it. It's like a workout. If you don't, you know, get in shape, like for spring training, and all the baseball players are getting in shape. If you don't feel sore, you're not working out enough. The idea is by the time the season starts, you're in great shape, and you can plow through 162 games without, you know, wearing down too bad. You'll wear down during the season a bit, but you're not going to get real sore muscles. Like, I can't even function. I'm so sore. I'm so terribly sore. That's what spring training is for. So we're in spring training right now, and it is literally spring, right in concert with what's going on in baseball. Is we're in spring training, and we're supposed to get sore, we're supposed to get weary, we're supposed to push things so we like, wow, I'm tired. So you have to be very aware of how you feel, and you have to be very aware of the intensity. The whole point of the sharpness of this practice is you're aware of the wow that's arising. It certainly does arise. It's the only practice I've ever come across that I can feel when I'm doing it. The wow arises very rapidly and powerfully, intensely, just wow. This, I can feel it working. Now, this is why stimulants, sex, drugs, and rock and roll are out of the picture. When you're a spiritual marine, those are out of the picture, because what those do is generate an artificial intensity, so you can't really tell where the intensity is coming from. So you can say, well, I can do anything because I feel this intensity, this jittery, this intensity, no matter what I'm doing. So I don't have to do this practice. I can't tell. Is this practice more effective than others? There's no way for me to tell. So it's a great defense against success. The sex, drugs, and rock and roll is a great defense against succeeding. It's very successful in keeping you from succeeding, because you will say, hey, I can't really determine if this practice is really effective or any more effective than another, or what's effective, because I feel jitter. I'm feeling the intensity no matter what I do. So when you take the sex, drugs, and rock and roll out of the picture, then you will easily be able to tell where the wow is coming from, where the intensity is coming from. It's coming from this practice. You say, ah, if I don't do this practice, I'm blah. When I do it, I can feel like, wow, this is just super intense. I'm feeling jittery. I'm feeling the intensity, the jitteriness of the intensity. And you'll say, I know it's coming from this practice and not from anything else. Whereas if you're artificially producing artificial intensity, you can't tell where the success is coming from. And so you cannot have the conviction of will to do the practice. Okay? Very simple, isn't it? Very simple. And it is truly the most diabolical thing you can do. The sex, drugs, and rock and roll defense is the most diabolical defense against success that there is, basically, because it confuses you. And confuses your will, and you can't build up the will to do the practice, because you just say, I'm not really sure. I'm confused. I'm not really sure where the intensity is coming from. It crushes your will. It crushes your will. I'm able to do this because my will, my spiritual will, knows that it's working. I can feel the intensity of it. I know the intensity is coming. That my defense is just, this is just absolutely packaging them up and disposing of it. Really. I'm aware of it. That's why I have the will to continue. If I wasn't aware of it, there's no way I could have the will to continue. No way. It takes conviction to do this practice. It takes conviction. Now, certainly, someone who's already succeeded at helps our conviction, but it, again, we still have to do the practice. Srinath Sargadatta Maharaj went to this guru who's already succeeded, and the guru said, just do this. And he said, okay, and he just did it. And I don't think he saw the guru again for, what, a couple years or a couple months, or I don't know. I didn't see him very often at all, really, because the guru just goes, hey, are you doing the practice? And yeah, okay, good, great, keep doing it. It's the practice that's the real guru. Okay, and then, but having seen the guru and seen the conviction, oh, it really works, this will work, it can help out. Sure, it can help out. But that's just an adjunct to actually doing it. Which is why Jesus says, better for you that I leave and the Holy Spirit be with you, which was the Holy Spirit, the great genius of practicing, that you actually start practicing instead of just hanging out with me and saying how wonderful I am and worshiping me and saying how great. It's better for you if I leave, you see, which is why Sri Sri Anandamayi would constantly move around. She never stayed with any group of disciples, devotees of practicing very long at all, very long at all. Would only stay a few days or a week in one place unless she's in retreat for some reason. But constantly moving around, say, no, don't. It's better for you if I leave. It's much better for you if I leave, because the practice is your real guru. And Ramana didn't even say anything, just silent, which was conveying the fact that, hey, it's your practicing's a real guru, you know. There was no personal engagement hardly with him at all. It's just absolute silence. Even like when Yogananda went to visit him. There's a video of that. And Yogananda's chatting up, but who's there? Paul Brunton or something, or I don't know, some Westerner. And Yogananda's smiling, they're chatting, and this is great, we're with Ramana Maharshi. Isn't this wonderful? Wow. Ramana was just sitting there like a stone. His expression didn't change in the slightest bit. Absolute silence. It's like, wow, here's this, you know, this guru, Yogananda, and this Westerner who can publicize, is writing books about you, and this, and they're all so happy to see you, and everything. His expression didn't change in the slightest bit. His expression did not change at all. His silence was absolutely not a ripple upon it. This is very intense. This conveys to us, wow. We've got to impress ourselves. We can't impress this guru at all. Really. It's our practice that's we have to do, you see. So that's one way of doing it. That's one way of doing it. He didn't go anywhere where Sri Sri Anandamayi, he was constantly traveling. Never, no one knew where she was. He just would pick up at a moment's notice and go somewhere else. At a moment's notice, ceaselessly moving about like this, touching base with so many, many practitioners, saying, what's your practice? How are you doing? And seeing if there's anything that need to be adjusted, like a tune-up, which is like a mechanic, a spiritual mechanic, tuning up very people's practices. That's all she was. She was a spiritual mechanic. And the vehicle she was mechanic on was spiritual practice. And so she sought out all these practitioners who were in everywhere, you know, all over the place, different situations, in caves, in a household, in an ashram, wandering about wherever. She would find them, seek them out and find them. She knew exactly how to find them, where they were, and just sit there quietly and then say, you know, I just noticed might be that there's a slight tweak on your practice might be helpful for you. In fact, I know it will be helpful. Maybe you should just do a slight adjustment. Or maybe you say, no, you're doing great. I just want to encourage you to keep doing. You're doing great. This is working for you. If there was a little tweak, she'd just suggest a little tweak. Just very gently and nicely, she had a way of doing this, which is very endearing, you see. As a mechanic, you gotta be careful when you're talking about tweaking someone's practice. And so she had the right touch for that, to do that, to tweak the practice just a little bit, to make it even more successful. And of course, the great adversary of successful practice is the rogue goddess. And so when we're practicing, we're afraid to upset the rogue goddess too much. You know, it's like, wow, she's gonna be furious with me. So the genius of Sri Sri Anandamayi was she appeared as if she were a goddess too, but she was higher than the rogue goddess. And so those who were afraid, who wanted to please the rogue goddess, said, well, if I please Anandamayi, that's sort of similar to pleasing the rogue goddess, similar enough, so I think I'll go ahead and do it. See, it's genius, spiritual genius at work there. And so they would be willing to tweak their practice in such a way as it would really dispose of the rest of the rogue goddess defensive system. You know, genius, really spiritual genius there. And of course, those who thought she was the goddess, the rogue goddess, would say, no, you got to stay with us. You can't go. And they say, our goddess is telling us you have to stay because we know that you are that goddess. And she say, I'm sorry. I'm sort of crazy and I can't seem to do what it pleases everybody, you know, and I just have to go. And I can't please everybody for some reason. I'm very sorry. She'd apologize and cry and everything, you know, and then she'd leave. But they tried their best to keep her from leaving. They insisted she can't leave. Like they commanded her not to leave. Why? Well, they were too lazy to do the practice. They wanted to worship a deity. Okay, they didn't want her going around and helping others out. You see, a lot of different reasons. You know, they said, no. We want you to help our defense system. We must be happy within our defenses. We don't really want to do the work. It's too tough. They said, no, you must do the work. You must do the work. Okay, and so now it's better that I leave you. See, this is the spiritual genius, better that I leave you. From those real heavyweights, Longchenpa also left Samye Monastery in Tibet. He was the head abbot, you know, the big cheese there. He said, no, I'm leaving. It's better that I leave, actually. And went wandering in caves and wandering about, and eventually the rogue goddess tried to assassinate him through thugs, the political intrigue of other sects that didn't like the sharpness of radical Dzogchen, okay? Didn't like the sharpness of that bit. They'd say, no, you got to be duller because it's too sharp, it's working too well, we don't like that. And so they tried to assassinate him. He was able to escape to Bhutan and do a lot of great help, encouragement there. So again, it is the practice that's the guru. And so these helpers, these encouragers, they know the practice is the guru. So I'm just drilling this into everyone. The practice is the guru. Don't let anything tell you otherwise. If Jesus shows up today, just say, Jesus, how am I doing with my practice? That's all. And, you know. And, you know, being the great mechanic, he is. Jesus is the great practice mechanic. Those three, all of those I've mentioned, are great spiritual mechanics working on the vehicle of our practice. Okay? All of them are great. And they've all collaborated to help out with this practice here. They've all got a very strong stake in it, actually. Jesus, Anandamayi, Sri Sri Anandamayi, Raman Maharshi, Longchenpa, all of those have a very strong stake in the sharpness of this practice, absolutely, in the format and in the sharpness of this practice. That's what they're all about in the Holy Spirit, which is the oneness of all of it. Okay, very strong stake in it because that's what they're all about. Is the practice is the guru. And by doing the practice, you are the guru, you see. You are the guru. You must impress yourself that you are the guru. You are the enlightened one. You are the enlightened one. You are the enlightened oneness. This is the enlightened oneness right now. This is already the enlightened oneness. This is already the enlightened oneness. That all is, that I am, that all is. This is already the enlightened oneness. Okay, now what phase of intensity are we at? Mid-phase intensity, right? We're practicing, yes, I already know, this is already the enlightened oneness. I already know, this is already the enlightened oneness. This is already the enlightened oneness. I already know, this is already the enlightened oneness. All is already the enlightened oneness. Yes, I already know that all is already the enlightened oneness. That I already am. That I already am. That I already am. This word already is crucial for the sharpness. It's extra sharp. It puts that extra sharpness on your drill bit. It puts that extra sharpness. I am all, we can say I am the oneness. But you say I am already the oneness. This really, you can feel immediately, you feel it digging into that resistance and cutting through it. And we say, wow, the intensity just jumps quantumly, really. It's a quantum word to use. It's a quantum, spiritual quantumness here. We're getting into spiritual quantumness by using this word already. Already. You can feel the phase shift there of intensity, of effectiveness when you put that word in. Say I am enlightened. And say, I am already enlightened. And conceptually, we just go, whoa, it just cuts through the conceptuality to an incredible extent. Not incredible, an amazing extent. It's certainly not conceptually credible, but it is actually. We can still conceptualize it as credible. It's just very intensely, very intense. So I would say it's wonderfully intense. So I'm feeling a bit of the wow right now, actually. This is generating some, as did the meditation this morning, that intensive, assertion intensive. All great religious traditions have a stake in this practice. because the whole goal of that is effective practice. Okay, is sharp enough practice. That is the goal. Absolutely, it's the goal. This is what we're supposed to, get to this point. So all of them have a stake in this, for sure. It's just I mentioned some of the teachers I've actually worked with directly, and they've worked with me directly. But I'm not saying that others don't have a stake in this. All traditions, religious traditions, have a stake in effective practice like this. So this practice supports all religious tradition. All religious tradition supports this practice, actually, because the ultimate aim is to impress yourself with the audacity of sharp enough spiritual practice so you realize, I am already this. I am already this. Yes, I am already this. I am already enlightened. I am already free. Yes, I know I'm already free. Yes, I know that I already know. Yes, I know that I already know. Yes, I am already I am. Yes, I know that I am already I am. Okay? And ultimately, we set down the attempt to deceive God, deceive ourselves, deceive God. We set down the whimsical idea of trying to be greater than God by making God lesser. We ultimately set that down. We ultimately set down perception and for knowing. But this takes us beyond the entire scope of the dream of time, space, process, form, entirely beyond it. Entirely beyond it. So that's not our pragmatic goal, and spiritual path is involved with pragmatic goal of I'm so delighted, overflowing with delight. You want a role model of overflowing with delight. Sri Sri Anandamayi was overflowing with delight. That's what they call it. Anandamayi means overflowing with bliss, delight. That's what Ananda is delight, spiritual delight or bliss, spiritual delightfulness. And Mayi means to overflow. So it's like a fountain, it's like this water sculpture that is flowing, overflowing with delight. We can reach this goal of overflowing with delight here. Absolutely we can. And she proved that you can function here perfectly well this way, overflowing with delight. And this gave us a very pragmatic goal to aim for. Very pragmatic goal to aim for. Very pragmatic goal to aim for. So it's very helpful. Pragmatism is very helpful there. Now the great silence of Ramana Maharshi helped draw us towards the ultimate goal. And in doing so, engage us in this goal of reaching this overflowing delightfulness, overflowing delightfulness. See, it's very helpful and compatible this way. What about the spiritual noumena that can come about by success? That actually takes attention off the body. It deflects your attention off of the body. It almost washes out the body, so to speak. If your body is like light, you're paying attention to the light, not actual the flesh at all, really. So the more lightfulness we can be, the better it is, the more we help others turn their attention from flesh to light, so to speak, to delightfulness. And Sri Sri Anandamayi was so delightful, overflowing with delight. People paid attention to the delight, not her body. Not her form, not her body at all, but the delightfulness was just so wonderful, so potent, that this is what people were pay attention to. Forget all about bodies. Well, bodies, I don't even pay attention to any bodies anywhere. What do you mean? There's this delightfulness. There's this fresh, ever-fresh delightfulness. This is what we want. This is the goal. This is the goal we can reach here and still be in the world. Okay? Absolutely we can, and we will. And if it's medium intensity, we say, I already know that I'm already overflowing with delight. I'm so delighted. I already know that I'm already so delighted. I'm overflowing with delight. I already know that I am already overflowing with delight. I already know that I'm already overflowing with delight. Yes, yes, I already know. Like, of course, yes, of course, I already know that I'm already overflowing with delight. Right use of faith. Right use of faith here. Yes, I already know I'm already overflowing with delight. Now, is this taping? I think, yes, it is. Okay, good. So I can edit this in with the first part that dropped out. As long as I keep it under the 2-hour and 10-minute mark. And if it's over, I'll just have to, you know, either put a part two in or just drop the last part. So what's the guru? The practice is the guru. You're looking for a guru? If you found this practice, you found the guru. You found the guru. It's the practice that's the guru. My whole life, I was looking for a guru. I never could find one. I was so upset. I said, everybody else, so many others are finding gurus. Oh yeah, I'm with such and such. Oh yeah, I've spent such and such in this retreat, and this retreat, and this one, and this. And I go, wow, I'm nothing. I mean, they're going, they have all these teachers, and they're getting help. And I'm nothing. This, you know, terrible. And the Holy Spirit always said, no, don't worry about it. Don't worry. And I couldn't understand. I really could not understand. I said, I'm a failure. No guru's interested in me at all. And what I didn't understand that the practice is the guru. I didn't understand it. I didn't get it. Because I couldn't find any practice that was worthy. So this practice is the guru. No, I couldn't find anything. I said, I didn't realize it was possible. Okay. And especially for this, our time, our situation. Now, you know, other times, other places, there are certain practices that had the sharpness for then. But they're not so sharp now for many of us. We need something that's sharp for us right here, right now. Very important. When this time, when the rogue goddess is trying to overwhelm our will and crush it to final crushment time here. This is designed to be the final crushment where our will never recover from this. This is these times, the time of the tribulation times, which is the end times, which is the time we are in. Make no mistake about that. Is designed to be the final crushment of our will so that we will never recover from it. This is what it's designed for. Okay, this is our defenses are designed this way to have a final crushment of our will so that we can never recover from it, and therefore this will then convince God that there's some external power, and that God itself then is subject to this external power, and that we've lowered God. So this is the time, the end times, where it is designed to be the final crushment. So we need something specifically for these times right now, okay? So not throwing shade on any other time, any other practice, any other time, because the results speak for themselves, okay? Results speak for themselves. But we are here right now in this situation, which has a unique intensity to it, actually. A very unique intensity to it. And this is the tough going right now, tough sledding. So we need a practice for right here, right now, this unique intensity. And so I looked at other practice other times. I said, it just doesn't quite, it's not quite enough for this situation right now. So I said, oh, how can practices be the guru? No, we need an actual guru to be here. And no guru ever showed up. So I said, wow, this is a failure. But what showed up is this practice. And now I'm hearing this practice is the guru. So the guru has shown up. The guru has shown up after all, thanks to the help of those great helpers that I've mentioned. And maybe some that I'm not even aware of, but I'm aware of working with these ones that I've mentioned. The big four, Jesus, Ramana Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi, Longchenpa, the big four that I've been conscious of meeting and working with them, and I feel that they're helping with this, absolutely, that getting this guru in place, which is the practice for these unique times. Every day you come across, if you have your attention, you notice I'm trying not to pay any attention to the world at all, but it seeps through a little bit, and it seems like constantly there's a new medical syndrome that's saying, do you have this? Do you have these symptoms? Well, you have this medical syndrome, actually. You have a medical condition. They say you have a medical condition, and guess what? We have a drug to treat it. not only one drug. We have many, many drugs in the pipeline to treat this, actually. And actually, and Jesus warned us, the original, I heard a real genius in linguistics pastor once. And he was very, I don't remember his name, but he was very, very renowned, and I had respect for him. I said, well, this guy knows what he's talking about. And he said what Jesus' words, in one of the songs he said, he used a term that really meant pharmaceuticals. And Jesus said the end times will be characterized by tremendous focus on pharmaceuticalness, that the whole planet will be engaged in believing in pharmaceutical cures. And this is exactly what is happening. You name it. The pharmaceutical industry and their minions will say that you have a medical syndrome that is treatable through pharmaceuticals, whatever it is. In fact, you probably have many, 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 many. And they're inventing new ones out of thin air all the time. From their standpoint, everything is a medical condition. Of course, from our standpoint, nothing is a medical condition, actually, ultimately. But we're not trying to assert that in particular, okay, over-assert that. Because pragmatically, we understand we have a practice we need to do, and we're still beginners, okay, on this practice. We're still beginners. But ultimately, nothing is a medical condition. It's all 100% mental pretense. 100%. There has never been any actual medical condition ever. But again, we're not making this some, you know, we're not trying to force this on anyone. I'm just bringing this up to contrast it with what this world, where this world is at now. Hold on. Which is, it seems like everything is a condition now. You've got, according to the world's viewpoint, the rogue goddess's viewpoint, with her favorite servants, the pharmaceutical companies, some of her favorites, everything's a medical condition. You are a medical condition. You are a biochemical medical condition that can be treated. And this is a clear-cut indication of the end times. Very clear-cut. Unambiguous, unequivocal. There's no doubt. If you put all the signs together, we are in this uniquely intense phase right now, designed the final crushment of our spiritual will. This is what it's designed for. Hold on here. Okay. It's designed for that, the final crushment of our spiritual will. And guess what? I already know that I've already succeeded in having pure spiritual will. I already know my spiritual will is absolutely uncrushable. Yes, I already know that my spiritual will is absolutely uncrushable, can never even be crushed in any way. Yes, I already know that my spiritual will is already pure sovereign of all. Yes, I already know that my spiritual will is already pure sovereign of all. Okay, yes, I already know. Now, what phase is this? What intensity? Mid-intensity, isn't it? So, yes, I already know. This is the form of the mid-intensity. Yes, I already know that my spiritual will is already sovereign over all. Already sovereign over all. There is no question about how to get here, blah, blah, blah. It's already that. Yes, I already know I'm already that. Yes, I already know that all is already that. Yes, I already know that all is already all. Mid-phase intensity, right? Mid-phase intensity. So you see, you're schooling yourself here. You're schooling yourself, which is super important. You're no longer ignorant. You're no longer without a practice. You're schooling yourself and saying, hey, I do have a practice. I do have a guru, actually. I actually do have a guru. This practice is my guru. I've accepted this practice as my guru. Absolutely, I have. This is why I'm doing it, because I know it's going to work. And in fact, in mid-intensity, it's just, I already know this already worked. Yes, I already know this practice has already worked for me. Yes, I already know this practice has already perfectly worked for me. Yes, I already know that this practice has already worked for me and succeeded. Oh, yes, I already know this practice has already successfully worked for me. It's already been the successful guru. Yes, I already know this practice has already been the successful, perfect guru. There you go. What practice? Mid-phase. Now, and what step are we in our practicing? Assertion step. Step one, assertion step. We're asserting this. So, and now, and then there's a little bit of wow, so we stop. We stop asserting. What are we in? Wow. We're in the wow phase a little bit here. And then as we start talking, we've shifted into the flipping of the script phase. Getting the nerve to go back to the practicing is what we do. So we sit up, spiritual Marines, we're impressing ourselves, we're sitting up straight. Head straight forward, and we're not slouching. We're just not slouching, and we're not goofing off. That's all. Very simple. We keep it very simple. We don't let the ego drag us into discussing all sorts of minutia. You know, ego loves to do that. Claims that it's just helping you get better. No, we have our three intensities, our three steps, and our three intensities, and with these three steps. These three steps apply to each of the three intensities. Right? These three steps are used with each of three intensities. Three intensities are what? First one, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Second intensity, yes, I already know that this practice has already been perfectly successful. Third intensity, I am already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Those are the three intensities. Three steps is the assertion, full stop in the wow, flipping the script, regaining momentum to start asserting again. And just repeat, 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 repeat until finally, you know, you're weary. You say, I'm finally reached this weariness, and you push that a little bit, but you don't push it too much. Your attitude, severely modest attitude, no sex, drugs, rock and roll, okay? And severely modest attitude. I'm just a beginner here, so that's it. I'm not trying to big time anything, I'm just a beginner. So let me be modest, unassuming, practice. Keep that attitude. Many times there have been those who were liberated from delusion, self-delusion, who set self-delusion down, set it down. And people were very surprised, astonished. Why, what are you talking about? You're just some weaver, some stonemason. You're just a laborer. You're just, you know, we hadn't even have a clue. You're even... anybody important at all? What is this? And they were secretly, quietly, unassumingly practicing a sharp enough practice so that they were able to honor their creativity enough and use faith in a positive way to be able to then set down, have this overflowing delight, and ultimately set down self-deception. They just kept this attitude of severe modesty, unassuming severe modesty. Nobody even knew they were practicing. Maybe in the evening they'd go to their room and spend time quietly sitting or something, and everybody said, didn't make anything of it, really. So a beginner is smart. That's being very smart and say, hey, I'm just a beginner, a lowly beginner, so let me get acquainted with the conventions here, the basics here, the conventions. Let me just get used to the basics. And what ultimately you find out is it's all the basics. It's all basic. So the attitude of just let me get used to the basics is really the winning attitude. That's why it's be severely modest in all ways here with the guru, which is the practice, because it's all the basics. It's only the basics. That's the sharpness of it, actually. It's very basic. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Yes, I already know that this practice has already been completely successful for me. Yes, I already know that this practice has already been completely successful for me. And I'm already so delighted to already see that I'm already not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. See, very basic, right? And then I feel the wow, okay, just let things settle down. Let me get used to this effectiveness. Let me get used to the shock that I'm actually drilling through this steel, which I've believed for so long that I could never do it. Nobody can do it. I can't believe. I've heard that maybe some have, but maybe that's myth, you know. And now I'm thinking, now I'm actually doing it. Wow! So you get used to the wow, and then you flip the script. You start regaining your will to do it again. It's all very basic. All very basic. So the severely modest attitude, hey, I'm just a beginner here. I'm just focusing on the basics. Cling to this attitude. Don't big time the situation. Cling to this attitude. I'm just a beginner here. I'm just focusing on the basics. I'm just a beginner focusing on the basics. This attitude is what you're looking for. Severely modest. See, we're so modest that we full stop in the wow, you know. I say, well, I think I need to take a break, a breather here. This is really something. And the ego says, wow, what's the matter? The drill's not working good. It's not sharp enough for you. I mean, I've got a better one that's sharp. Let's go look for a sharper one. You say, no, I'm taking a break because the drill's so sharp and I'm making so much progress. I'm kind of worried I might make a breakthrough like today. And I'm not quite sure I'm ready for that. Let me let this settle down. Let me get used to this success here for a little while. That's what's really happening. So I'm just a beginner. I'm just starting out here. I'm taking a little break because I'm not quite used to the intensity of this success yet. So I'm taking a little break here and get calm, get a breather here. Yeah. It's full stop on the wow. Very important. Let me take as much time as needed to kind of settle down. We're just beginners here. We're just getting used to the basics here, so we're just beginners, see? So we take a little time to calm down here. We're not used to such incredible success, right? Yeah, we're just beginners here with this incredible success. Of course, you don't need much incredible success. I'm sorry, that's a wrong word. We're just getting used to this tremendous success. We're just getting used to this tremendous success. And of course, we don't need much tremendous success to actually succeed, to get through that steel. If you're going through that steel, great guns, and you can see the holes, well, you know, it's not going to be long until you're through. So we don't even have time to get advanced. We're just focused on the basics here, and before you know it, boom, we're already finished. I already know I'm already finished. Yes, I already know that I'm already finished. See, we're getting ready for finishing because it's going to come quickly. So yes, I already know that I'm already finished. Sneeze is trying to arise here. Suppressed it there. All right. That takes will, focus, concentrate on will and focus there. You get these from time to time, absolutely. It's actually a sign your practice is working very well. hands to hands. You know, don't start rubbing your nose, touching your face. No. If you have to sneeze, you sneeze. But try to avoid it. Try to suppress any reaction. I'm getting some more. Sometimes you get tingling irritations, really, that feel like you've got to scratch or itch it. It's really extremely distracting. You say, okay, full stop in the wow. So let's settle down. No slouching, no goofing off, hands to hands, severely modest. Easy to remember. That's very basic. I'm just the basics. The ego says, what about all the other stuff you're supposed to know? Well, I'm just really beginners. I'm just dealing with the real basics right here, and that's all I'm focusing on right now. I'm just a mere beginner at all this, so I'm not going to overload myself with a bunch of other rules and details and minutiae. Severely modest, sitting quietly, just sit quietly without slouching, no goofing off, severe modesty, hands to hands. You can take a little sip of water if you need to, okay? And that's it. We're just beginners, that's all. Just instructions for beginners. And yes, I already know that this practice has already been totally successful for me. Yes, I already know that this practice has already been totally successful for me. Yeah, and you know you're serious if you're not goofing off, right? If you're willing to not get goofy. You know, kids, they say, oh, I got plenty of time, let me be goofy. Well, actually, how much time do we have right now in this world until you reach the point of this final encrunchment of a spiritual will that the world is now, you know, amping up, implying the hydraulic pressure, so to speak. And then we don't have much time at all, as a matter of fact. We're right in the middle of it. Our spiritual will, this planet, is getting crushed, so to speak. At least, that's the overwhelming pretense. Very clever pretense, but that's where our creativity is being applied, is to this pretense of a final spiritual will encrushment. And that encrushment can seem very, very plausible to us. So how much time do we have to goof off, actually? So you know, if you're young, say you're a young person, you can take the attitude, oh, I got plenty of time to goof off. Really? Not really. I stopped trying to goof off from the very beginning here in this life. I tried not to goof off. Of course, it's difficult because you got a lot of people, other young people, your generation, everybody's goofing off and say, hey, why don't you goof off too? You know, so of course, it's difficult when you're young. There's no question about it. But what good is that excuse? I mean, this we're in this unique time already. So it's too, you can't use that excuse anymore of youth. You got to say, you know what, that excuse is, I'm not going to play that card. That's off the table, because that's a failure to play that card. The card of excusing goofing off. Too late to play that card. It's already too late to play that card. So yes, I already know it's already too late to play that card. Now, can young people do this? Absolutely they can, of course. They can be intensely focused on studying to get into Stanford, for instance. If their goals are, I got to get into Stanford, you know, that they're going to spend how many, 8 hours? I once spent time with someone that their whole life was school and study. They'd lock themselves in their room and they'd come home from school, lock themselves in their room, come back for dinner, go back to their room. That's all they ever did. Intensely studying to get into the highest university. I was in, that's not important where it was, but this happens. And this young person, so he said, "Hey, I can't. If I goof around, I'm going to fail to get into that university. Guaranteed, it's a failure. Guaranteed failure." So he said, "I'm not going to goof around. No way." Young person, teenager. My memory's a little bit correct. It may be that they already had gotten into the university, but to get into the, there are others to get into the university. There's a whole group of very high level students there that I was engaged with. And all of them were this way. And they told me, this is the way you have to be. If you want to have be a really successful career, there's only one, you know, you got to get into this university, and you have to, and then you will be end up being a CEO, you'll be a top leader of the country industry. So I was made aware of how serious they were. And they were all young, you see, they were all young. Late teens, early 20s, so to speak. Now, you don't want to overdo it. Nobody wants to overdo it. But ultimately, it's a decision that everybody makes. Now, maybe you won't be able to do it quite as much as older people. That's fine. Do as much as you can. Is it easier when you're older? I'd say you could make a case, you know, that hindsight shows you what doesn't work, and then realize that if you don't do what works, you're going to have another life of utility following this one, and that scares you for sure. And you realize you're running out of years to succeed. And so certainly it adds incentive, but if you wait too long, you'll be too feeble, you know, pretty much. So you can end up being feeble and not do it. So I would say, no matter what age you are, do the very best you can and get better at it. And remember, you're just a beginner. So it's okay. I'm young, I'm old, I'm just a beginner. I'm just focusing on the basics here, because all we have here is basics, actually. All we have are the basics here. So there is a lot of wow factor to this, I'm feeling, but not overwhelming. That's the price I pay for doing this. I pay a heavy price for sure, of weariness, tiredness, fatigue. Because I have to push this through into format here. I have to get this done. I got timetable. I mean, I got to get it done so it's not too late, you know. And so the encroachment hasn't already been too much for everybody, and it's already being too much for many. And we don't want to lose those who really spiritually has great spiritual will to succeed. We don't want to lose those here now. We want a guru for that, which is this practice is a guru. I'm not saying it's the only guru. It is a guru, a very, I believe, top-notch guru, this practice. Certainly capable of helping those who have the spiritual will to truly succeed now and go, take this intermediate step of overflowing delight. Okay. And overflowing delight, knowing, seeing that I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Actually seeing it. Actually seeing the truth of this. This is true. And this brings this overflowing delight with it. Vision of oneness. Vision of one. You know. You're seeing. Now, it's not knowing yet. That's positive use of faith conceptually. But really, healed perception is a seeing. It's not yet a knowing. But it is a seeing. A very clear seeing. I am not the body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. So, we don't want to lose those to a delay of a feeling of crushed will, a final encroachment of their will, saying, "Ah, I tried, but there's no way to do it." You see, we don't want that. Nobody wants that. Nobody wants that. So, with the attitude of severe modesty, be a beginner. Just be a beginner here. So everybody's a beginner here, okay? You're one with everyone else. We're all beginners here. We're all simply into the basics here. That's it. All right? We're all beginners here. No matter how high and mighty we may have been somewhere else, here with this guru, we're all beginners. That's it. And we're all focused on the basics of just getting really good at the basics. That's all we're focused on here. Everybody. I don't care if you've written, 20 books, spiritual books, and you study with this lineage and this lineage and done this, whatever you've done. Here with this guru, we're all beginners. We're all simply focused on the basics. So we're not trying to, compare big time, greater, lesser, whatever. Forget all that. That's out the window right now. That's out the window. Because with this guru, we're all just beginners. We're all just faced on the we're just focused on the basics, getting familiar with the basics. That's it. That's all. That's all. So come on in, everybody. Come on in to this practice. Come on in. The guru is here. The guru, the practice is the guru. The guru is here. Come on in, and you're a beginner along with me, along with everybody else. We're just beginners here at this. We truly are. Of course, with this practice, the beginning phase is all you need. I think ultimately that's how it will turn out to be, actually. This guru is so potent. That's the beginning. Just getting good at the basics is all you actually need to do. But you do have to do that. You absolutely do have to do that. And of course, you don't have familiarity with this yet. So you are a beginner. Again, I don't care how many books someone has published, how many lectures they've given. I don't care if they've been a spiritual teacher to someone, this and that. Well, whatever your status is in this world or has been through previous incarnations, here it doesn't matter. You still have to get used to the basics here because you're not familiar with these, with this type of basics. You're not. This is unique practice. You have to become very familiar with the basics here. So you're a beginner here. You're absolutely a beginner. And you have to prove to yourself that you're a spiritual marine, that you can actually, you have to actually impress yourself by actually doing it. And intellectually grasping it is not enough impressiveness. Does not impress you enough. No way. As I said, you can write 20 great books and sell millions and millions of copies of books and everyone say, what a great spiritual intellect you have. But you are still not impressed. And you know that for a fact. No matter how smart you are spiritually, intellectually, in all spiritual matters, you're still not really impressed by that. Nobody is. So you have to find a guru that will truly impress you when this practice is the guru. Actually doing the practice is the guru. And that will impress you. And then you'll say, wow, I have honored my creativity. I can now set self-deception down. And eventually your attention will effortlessly, like flower petals falling to the ground or something, just effortlessly, just gently, your attention will relax into the true non-dual attention, effortlessly. At some point, we're not worried about what that point is at all. We're just concerned about getting there. That will happen on its own accord. It's on its own accord. First, you have to impress yourself. Truly impress yourself and truly honor your creativity. Truly honor your creativity. So, come on in, everyone. Come on in. Come on in and meet the guru. Meet the guru. The practice is the guru. The practice is the guru. The practice is the guru. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome. Doesn't have anything to do with me directly at all. Somebody said, well, I don't like him, or I feel angry or upset. It doesn't matter. The practice is the guru. Practice is the guru. Someone doesn't like me, or it doesn't matter to me. The practice is the guru. I'm still going to practice it no matter what. All that other stuff is just incidental. That's taking your attention off the guru. If you got a great guru, you're going to take your attention off of them, so to speak? No. Keep your attention on the guru, not on the peripherals. If you go to see a great guru like Ramana Maharshi, are you going to be focused on the other people that are there and talking with them and say, oh yeah, it's great to see you. I'm so happy to meet you. And then, socialize. Those are peripherals. Are you going to be quiet and still and let the inner effect take place and feel the inner practice happening within you, so to speak, that was induced by Ramana Maharshi, could be induced by that stillness, your attention is going to be upon that. You're not going, someone else, how do I feel about someone else's here and someone else, forget it.